I saw Dogman rise from a sinkhole in the woods. Dear Scary Stories NYC, my family had a year in which we were plagued by at least one Dogman, but it was only that year, and then it never happened again. Both me and my brother Teddy were teens at the time, and my parents were going through life changes as well. It was almost as though the Dogman were a manifestation of our collective fear, the way they say poltergeists might be manifested by or because of young people enduring a difficult puberty. I'm going to tell you the story in the headline, the one about the Dogman in the water-filled sinkhole in the woods. But that wasn't our first experience with the creature. The story of our first Dogman experience went like this. Teddy and I were playing catch in the back of the house, right over by the edge of the tree line. We used to like to play this game with a baseball that we called Pop Fly at the Astrodome. We would throw the ball as high as we could, then watch it bounce off tree branches and trunks, and try to catch it on the ricochet before it hit the ground. We were playing that game one autumn evening as the sky grew dark, and Teddy started to become distracted. I asked him what was wrong, and eventually he told me that he didn't like the looks of that dog. I was like, "What dog?" But then I turned and I saw it. There was a dark gray or black dog peeking out at us through a bush inside the tree line. Its head was just a couple or 3 feet off the ground, and it had intense eye shine, which gave it a weird and intimidating presence. I wondered if it might be friendly, so I took a step forward toward it, talking to the beast nicely as you would to a pet. The dog showed me its teeth and growled, so I stopped walking toward it. Teddy got very angry at that growling. He didn't like anyone threatening his family. Ted picked up some pebbles and tossed them in the direction of the animal, shouting at it to go away. It didn't go away. Instead, the dog head began to rise directly up, 4 feet, 5 feet, over our heads. By the time it was finished rising, we could see that the wolf-like cranium with the large teeth and the angry face was sitting on top of a broad chest, resembling that of a human wrestler. We were looking up at the glowing eyes of some kind of bipedal creature who had been squatting behind that bush. It looked like a werewolf or a wolfman, but one with a long dog snout and who wore no clothes as the werewolves did in the movies. At least back then, I mean. I guess that might not have been true for a long time, but this story is from a long time ago. So I was craning my neck looking up at the 7 or 8 foot tall hairy Dogman as it looked me up and down, its eyes lingering longest on the fleshiest parts of me. I noticed the upright walking wolf was salivating as my brother grabbed me and pulled me behind him, shielding me from the monster with his own body. The dog continued to growl and continued to salivate at the sight of us, but it held its position as we backed slowly away. When we were at what felt like a far enough distance, we ran back to the house. Inside there, we both had emotional breakdowns, weeping, I think, largely in relief. Plus, we were still young. That was quite a nasty surprise we received out there. Not only had we seen our lives pass in front of our eyes, but we had made ourselves a new enemy, or frenemy at least. But we didn't know that term back in those days. What I'm trying to say is that now my brother and I were on the Dogman's radar. My family had a horrible year in 1987. My father lost his job and didn't find another full-time gig until 88 or 89. My mom went to work, and my brother and I found ourselves suddenly with hardly any supervision at all. Obviously, that was mostly great as far as we were concerned, but it sucked that we had nobody to talk to about the Dogman. After all, that wasn't just a sighting at a distance, and the creature had exhibited hostile and challenging behavior. I got the impression that he viewed himself as far above us on the food chain. That wasn't a kind of encounter one really wants to have in the backyard on your family's property. Teddy and I stopped playing earlier each afternoon from then on, but even when the sun was out, we were never truly comfortable in those woods ever again. Teddy and I weren't the only ones to be seeing the Dogman that year either. We found out that a kid we'll call Bert from one of Teddy's classes had been followed from near his home to school one dark, overcast morning. Teddy and I came upon him being bullied and made fun of by other boys, but when we asked him what was going on, it turned out he was claiming that he had seen a real werewolf. Teenagers are so kind to each other, so you can only imagine how badly they were giving it to this poor guy. But Ted and I kind of believed him, for obvious reasons. For even more obvious reasons, we didn't want to discuss our experiences in front of these intolerant and mean kids. We caught up with Bert later on, though, and we compared notes. He said the thing was black and 10 feet tall, with glowing eyes, and that it growled and steam rose from its nostrils. That would definitely be way taller than the one we saw, but then again, Bert might have just been overestimating the size of the creature due to his fright level when this was happening. According to this guy, there's a point along the way when he walked to school where he had to pass a patch of woods. He used to enjoy that part in the past, but on that particular morning, it seemed extra creepy. Something was just off. Even before seeing the monster, he knew something was not right. When the huge, nasty-looking, matted fur reanimated corpse-looking upright dog shambled out of those woods, he claimed he was almost half expecting it. He froze on the spot and was about to run back home when the Dogman unexpectedly departed the scene. It ran off into another patch of woods on the other side, and he couldn't see it anymore. Bert said it took a long time for him to get up the courage to go back to walking to school. He convinced himself that the creature was gone and that the incident was over. He told himself inside that he was safe, but he didn't really believe it. After some time, Bert heard the sound of a dog walking on the road behind him, and there it was. The Dogman was pacing him, about 60 or 70 feet behind, according to Bert. It was maintaining the same distance, never getting closer, and never falling back either. Its glowing eyes seemed to bore into his mind when he looked at them, so Bert turned around and returned walking to school, maybe a bit faster this time. Then it felt like the Dogman's eyes were boring into his back. When he finally reached a more populated area, Bert said the feeling of being watched dissipated, and when he turned around, the Dogman seemed to be gone. He told us both that he was taking the bus home, and he'd be taking the school bus to school in the mornings from then on. And it wasn't only teenagers dealing with the werewolf sightings and harassment, although the adults had different kinds of reactions to their sightings. One night, my mother came back from her job crying. I asked her what was wrong. I thought maybe her boss at work was giving her trouble or something. Instead, she told me this story about what she perceived to be an injured dog. According to the story Mom told me, she was driving on the highway alone and there wasn't much traffic, so she got distracted with her cigarette lighter and almost looked up too late when a so-called injured dog ran out onto the road directly in front of her car. I asked how she knew it was injured, and Mom told me that it was running on its hind legs, so therefore, its front legs must have become injured for it to do that. I got chills all over. My mother had seen an upright walking canid, and she had felt pity for it. Instead of screaming, instead of being afraid, instead of panicking and slamming on the gas to get out of there, my mother thought that the scariest monster on earth might be hurt. She wanted to stop and help it. That was my mother. That's just the way she was. God love her. So, after narrowly missing the Dogman as it blocked her lane, She managed to screech to a halt, and she opened her car door to get outside. She just missed slamming into a dog man, and her concern was with his well-being. My mother was a good woman, but not always logical. So, according to her, the dog turned and looked at her, and she could tell it was very injured because its eyes glowed an orangey golden color in the darkness. I asked her how that was a sign of illness, and she said that eyes glowing was a way the animal had to heal itself, like a cat purring. I grew up thinking that was true, but now I think she just made it up. I've never again run into anyone who felt that eye shine was in any way associated with either injury or healing. So, now my mother almost ran down an upright walking canid, right? She stopped her car, opened the door, leaned out, and witnessed the legendary Dogman eyeshine. Then, according to my late mother, the creature ran off on its hind legs into the woods at such an impossibly fast speed that she knew it must be very injured. I asked how an injured animal would be able to run at all, let alone faster than physically possible, and my mother wept for a while before answering, "It's the adrenaline that kicks in when they're about to pass on." She cried. Someone about to cross over to the afterlife is occasionally capable of performing impossible feats, she informed me. That was another thing I grew up believing. Mom meant well, and she always tried her best. She wasn't the only one to be bothered by the Dogman, though. One night my dad woke the whole house up with a scream that sounded like someone had ripped his very soul out of him somehow. He claimed he had seen yellow glowing eyes outside his window, staring at him. Mom never made the connection with her sighting of the so-called injured dog, but I know Teddy and I both thought the same thing. That was the dog man. And if he was looking in the window at our house, he was probably looking for me and Ted. We drew the curtains to cover all our windows before trying to get back to sleep that night. One day, it started pouring once we were deep into the woods. Neither of us ever checked weather reports, and I know I still forget to do that into my old age. We ran back home in the downpour, and on the way, we noticed the rain bowl filling up. The rain bowl was our family's own made-up name for a little sinkhole in the woods behind our home that was big enough for me and Ted to play in when we were younger. It was kind of a shallow sink shape, and when it would rain, the water would collect there for a few days. So after the rain was done, we had a nice big rain puddle to jump in and splash all over the woods. It was a place we liked to go since we were very young, as soon as it was done raining. Our father had showed it to us when he used to spend time with me and Ted, something which he was no longer doing during that difficult period. Mom never liked the rain bowl. She always said we'd catch a cold, but Dad used to encourage us to have fun in the early days. When we were very young, the water in the rain bowl would come up to the top of my legs. By this point in our lives, when all this was taking place, it might have come up to maybe just under my knees when it was fully maxed out with water. It was still fun to take a running jump into, however, and so we knew we were going to head straight there in the morning. This was during a brief period in which Teddy was getting up at dawn to go jogging, and so I joined him. It was a cloudy morning, and still very dark and spooky looking out, as we made our way through the woods along the path there. We were coming up to the rainbow, and my plan was to try to take Ted by surprise. I was letting him run in the lead while I followed, but I hoped to turn on an extra burst of speed at the last second, and be the first to jump into the newly filled virgin rainbow. We reached the point where I had chosen to accelerate, but Ted surprised me by suddenly stopping, holding his arm out to the side to halt my forward momentum too. I slid into him while trying to stop, and the two of us knocked each other's feet out from under ourselves. We landed hard on our behinds, looking directly forward at the rainbow. The big sinkhole depression in the forest that was filled to the brim with rainwater, and we saw something weird and dark coming up out of that water. I thought at first it was a very large slug, like a super giant black slug, and that its two large antennae were beginning to emerge from the big puddle. As the two dark, wet protuberances continued to come up from the liquid, however, they looked more like the ears of a big cat, or maybe a dog. Reality check. There was not enough depth to that waterhole for a cat or dog with ears that large to be hiding in. And yet, the ears moved higher, showing us two amber glowing eyes underneath them, as well as the rest of an unhappy looking dog head. But it wasn't as though the animal were rising up from having been squatting down in the water. It was more as though it were rising up in an elevator. Or I suppose a better comparison might be that it seemed to have swimmed up to the surface. That little sinkhole, in that moment, appeared to be deep. We knew it was not. We knew every crack in the floor of that thing. And yet, this doghead had crested the surface of our rain bowl, defying the laws of space, time, and physics. On top of that, this was another one of those glowing-eyed, dog-headed people, just like the one who had looked in on Father, just like all of them. Possibly, there was only one of the things, and this was it. I shouldn't even have to tell you that we turned around and went back home. I don't know what else anyone anywhere in the world would have done in our situation. I can't speak for my brother, but I did not look back. The creature was only half out of the water when we started running. We had no interest in waiting until he was all the way out. Obviously, the Dogman and the rain bowl were the main topic of discussion between me and my brother for the rest of that day. Teddy said the hole clearly led to an underground passage that the Dogman had risen up out of. I asked him why we never saw that opening before. I asked him why we never fell through that opening down into the supposed passage. We had been jumping up and down on that rain bowl for years, and there was no crack in it. There was no leak. There certainly couldn't be an underground passage. Ted pointed out that the Dogman had to have risen up from somewhere. So that meant there was an underground passage. There absolutely had to be. Nothing else was possible. We didn't go back to the big puddle until the following afternoon, a sunny day when the weather had gotten warmer. Not only had that waterhole shrunk up to about half its depth already, but there was no hole at the bottom of it. We carefully explored it, prodded it, stepped on it, jumped on it, but there was no opening at all, not even one big enough for ants to crawl through. There couldn't be a hole there, and there never had been a hole there. At no point in all my years of experience with that rain bowl was the water ever deep enough that it would come up to my belly, not even when I was small. But we both saw that water was up to the belly of that immense Dogman as it rose out of the hole. Explain that to me if you can. It's almost as though the hole were managing to be two things at once, both deep and shallow. Neither of us were ever able to explain that incident to each other or to ourselves. If we hadn't been together when it occurred, I think we'd just assume it was a weird hallucination. The thing that makes it a true mystery for us is that we both witnessed the identical thing. So winter came on, and by spring of the next year, we weren't thinking so much about the Dogman anymore. Well, except when we happened upon the rain bowl, of course. The Dogman rising out of it had broken us out of our childhood routine of running to the big permapuddle after each big rain. Nothing was ever the same again for me or my brother, and I believe we can trace it all back to the fact that I saw Dogman rise from a sinkhole in the woods. As long as we're hobnobbing, please give some thanks to Robin. I've got a lot to say about our EP, Robin May. Please join me in thanking today's executive producer, Robin May, for making this episode possible. In exchange, Robin gets to see our weekly Sunday Secret Uncensored Stories, our 21 hours of archived uncensored stories, and now $7 members like Robin May get free secret advance preview episodes each Wednesday. We call it Werewolf Wednesday. Here's our spokesdog, Henry Lee Dogman, with more details. Hank. Thanks for watching till the end. If you liked what you saw, please consider clicking like on the video or sharing it with your friends and family that you think might also be interested. If you would like to see more of our work, please consider subscribing and hitting that bell icon next to the subscribe button so that YouTube will alert you when we put out a new video. To become a channel member and gain access to our special perks, you can click that join link under each of our videos. Another option is to join our PayPal subscribers club at peterbernard.com. You can join for as little as 99 cents on YouTube or $1.50 at peterbernard.com, and that gains you access to our weekly secret uncensored episodes. If you'd like to see our 21 hours of archives of uncensored Dogman stories, then please join at the $3 level or above. To get to watch our shows in advance of the public, please join at our $10 level. That gets you all the perks. If you join our channel memberships, you need to check our community page here on YouTube in order to get the links to the secret videos and other perks. If you're in the PayPal Subscribers Club, Peter will email you all the news and links himself. Once joining the PayPal Club, which is Peter's homemade club, please give him a chance to see that you've joined and to compose you a personal welcome email, as none of that is automated. But whichever you join, we'll name you an executive producer for the next available episode. Do you have a scary experience that you'd like to share with us? You can email us at scarystoriesnyc@gmail.com or call our Scary Stories voicemail hotline at 804-LE-SCARY. That's 804-537-2279. It's a Google voicemail box, so that means it keeps cutting off after every 3 minutes. If your story is longer than that, please keep calling back and we can piece it together on our end. Good night, and have a scary tomorrow.
Scary story.